Maybe, maybe they affirmed their that they are in favor of the death penalty under the particular circumstances of their society. Because maybe in the in U.S. society, it's not quite it's now quite difficult to control, considering the freedom, the extreme freedom that people are allowed to exercise, and they're very difficult to control. Maybe that's the reason for their change of heart with respect to death penalty.
That will be all.
Thank you.
Mr. Chief.
Congressman Topaz will no longer ask question. It's now the turn of Secretary Mosngi.
Thank you, Chair. I think my questions have already been propounded. I am satisfied with the answers. I have already enough to form an opinion. I give it to the Chair, Mr. Chair.
Okay, Attorney De Castro, what is your inclination? Resolve the issue for the common good? Or resolve the issue in favor of what you know and believe is just and right? Is it between common good or just and right? What is your inclination?
You know, if you're in the judiciary, your task is to dispense justice. And justice is supposed to be blind. The question of common good is something, is a pronouncement of policy. And if you're in the judiciary, your task is not to pronounce policy, but to distribute or dispense justice. You have a rule of law, you have a set of facts, then you decide what rule will apply to a set of facts. But for the question of common good, although it's also used in our constitution, it's a question of, the issue is policy. It's more addressed to the legislators because they will have to determine whether something that they will adopt as law is for the common good. So I think in our system of government, where there are different branches of government, they have specific spheres of authority and power, the judiciary's task is to dispense justice.
Okay. Now, aside from the qualifications, general qualifications provided in the Constitution, independence, probity, integrity, and probity and integrity. No? Are there other independence? Are there other traits and virtues that a candidate should possess in order to be an effective Chief Justice?
I think that Chief Justice should also be humane, mm-hmm. because he or she is not only a dispenser of justice, but being a head of office, he or she has to be an administrator. And you know, you have employees, justices are also people, judges are people, they have their own wants and needs, and they work for a living. And that's why you have to be humane. You don't dispense justice to your employees, even if you're in an organization. You try to reach their needs, to feel for them. And that's the difference between an associate justice who is charged with making decisions, dispensing justice, writing all these, evaluating facts, applying the law, and a chief justice who is also an administrator and a manager.
Must also be a good administrator.
Of course.
Okay. Mm. In fact, he is the chief administrator of the Supreme Court.
Looks like.
Looks like. Now, you will be coming from the outside, assuming that you are appointed chief justice. How would you lead the Supreme Court? Because you are coming from the outside. And how will you deal and lead with 14 justices of the Supreme Court?
I don't have to deal or lead the justices of the Supreme Court because they themselves are leaders. We will be coordinating with each other. We will be cooperating and we'll be working together. Mm-hmm. the leadership of the Chief Justice lies in running the machinery of the judiciary smoothly and efficiently as possible. I am sure there are problems of employees, their salary structure, the wage structure, and their tenure of office. I'm sure there are lots of problems. And procurement and equipment, those would be the details. And probably you have to evaluate whether there's a need for delegation of powers, considering that it's quite decentralized. You know, all those details. So that makes a difference between being a Chief Justice and a Justice.
Were you involved in the past as head of an association or a body?
I was Executive Vice President for Legal and Audit of Benguet Corporation.
Oh.
And I resigned with the position of CEO.
CEO, that means
Chief Operating Officer.
Chief Operating Officer. When was that, Tony?
I retired at the age of 55 in 1998. I was there for 16 years. So I rose from the ranks from as group manager, and I dealt with labor unions, collective bargaining agreements with miners, and strikes and whatever, almost everything.
You are related to Attorney De Castro?
Which one? There's so many.
The older one.
Arturo
De Castro, yeah.
Ah, he's my husband.
Your son is also Arturo.
Yeah, actually, I have three children who are lawyers, and so I have spun off our conjugal partnership, the law office, into a law firm with my children. That's why I was able to, retire since last year. But I'm still, I have to advise them so they face in.
Okay. Any other? Okay. That's all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you also for coming.
Thank you, Congressman Tupas.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Second nominee to be interviewed by the JBC is Attorney Soledad Cagampang de Castro. When asked why she accepted the nomination, she said that she thought that the JBC should have alternatives, and maybe the Supreme Court can look beyond from those inside. De Castro is 67 years old. She was asked about the possible short time she would serve if ever she was chosen as Supreme Court Chief Justice, and she said that she will just work double time. When asked if she is physically fit or can she physically handle it, she said the last physical examination said that she is fit to work. Her experience of being part of management, she notes, can help her in the administration of the Supreme Court. Gender equality was raised in one of the questions by the members of the JBC. She said that there's always a glass ceiling for women. A gender perspective may change for cases involving violence against women, but it should not be an issue for most of the cases. She also mentioned that pre-law preparations is inadequate, lacking in values and ethics training.
Department of Justice.
You may take your seat, Honorable Secretary.
Good morning, Your Honors. Yeah. I understand that I have the option to...